It's Wednesday, it's 7 o'clock, it's time for Magic TV. I should say it's party time. That's probably the more appropriate thing. It's party time.
Didn't that die out already?
Never, it'll never die. Never. I'm Mashi Scanlon, the guy on the left. With me, Paul Cheon, Humph, Darksteel Humphrey, and our very special guest, Sam Pardee. How's it going, Sam?
Pretty good. Back from the Pro Tour, feeling good.
Nice, nice. You guys had an amazing Pro Tour. Okay, you know what? I shouldn't leave it out. We didn't get Burglar this week. We do have, behind the camera, Channel Fireball Editor-in-Chief Andy Cooper-Faust running things, as he often does behind the scenes for the website, but physically present and running things for Magic TV for us this week. So thank you, Andy. All right, now back to how things are. We're back from the Pro Tour. Had a great showing. We're going to dive into everything with the Pro Tour. I mean, it just seemed like this was a Pro Tour that a lot of people were watching, and there was a lot of feedback on, obviously. But we've got our Oath of the Gatewatch Pro Tour Oath of the Gatewatch review. We'll talk about Eldrazi. We'll talk about testing for the Pro Tour. Any final thoughts on Limited for BFC Draft and the new meta post Pro Tour? And of course, we have our top eight. Before we get into any of that, I want to remind all of you of two things. Well, remind you of one and let you know about another. I want to remind you, Channel Fireball is hosting a Grand Prix in Houston. It is our first, well, not counting Europe, it's our first domestic non-West Coast GP. Did that make sense? Yeah, sorry. I never know. First of all, here's a question I've grappled with many times. Is Las Vegas on the West Coast?
It's on the West. It's Pacific time.
It's not
it's Pacific time zone.
But it's not a coast, so.
Well, it's in the desert 4 hours away from
water. So, but that's a big argument whether it's West Coast or not. But
I would say it's not West Coast. But
regardless, Houston, definitely not West Coast. If you head to gphouston.com, you can pre-register for that event right now. Strongly suggest you do it. We've got an amazing side event schedule. It's going to be a great main event. Come out to Houston and check it out. I just saw the GP Houston t-shirt, and I think it's awesome. It's basically just the Channel Fireball shirt you guys are wearing, but he's got a cowboy hat on, which is it's kind of fun. You got to see it. Trust me, it's funnier when you see it. I think it's great. I'm really looking forward to checking that out. So go to GP Houston, pre-reg. We got a lot of room in this venue. That isn't to say we have infinite capacity, but book your tickets, book your hotel room, and pre-reg for the event. One fell swoop, kind of a set it and forget it. So please, please, please make sure you do that. Also, Channel Fireball, we're in the midst right now on the website of restocking a bunch of stuff. So if there are singles, particularly modern singles, particularly maybe modern singles that might be in BFZ block, check out Channel Fireball in the coming days. We're restocking right now, so we're going to be fully loaded and ready to rock and roll for all of that modern stuff. So check out channelfireball.com. Of course, Magic TV brought to you by channelfireball.com. So let them know you appreciate it by checking out the website. Okay, before we get started, a little bit of somber news. Just found out that Magic illustrator Christopher Rush has passed away. It was crazy. His agent, actually, Jeff Ferreira, is a local guy, and he gave Channel Fireball president and CEO John Sasso a call to let him know that it happened. And for those of us who go to a lot of GPs, Chris has been a mainstay on the GP circuit since artists have started showing
up. Yeah, he's
always
there.
Yeah, he's at every one domestically. He didn't do any international shows, but it's weird. It's weird for me because, like, I knew Chris really well. You know, we weren't, like, drinking buddies. We're really good friends. And so it's been, I just found out about an hour before we went live, but, you know, best wishes and thoughts and prayers to Chris and Chris's family. He, you know, he's part of the history of Magic. The iconic cards that he did, the development he did, kind of in the early days of Magic were huge. We'll have a special top eight for Christopher Rush cards at the end of the show. One of the other lesser known facts is, you know, for a while, Wizards of the Coast had the license for Pokemon in the U.S. before, I think, Nintendo has it
now.
Did
he draw Pokemon?
He drew an alternate art Mewtwo. He was the first American illustrator to draw a Pokemon card. And even today, like, there's very, very few American artists who've done Pokemon stuff. So it's like one of the random things, like, he mentioned once that he like drew Mewtwo. But man, Chris was a great guy, and you kind of couldn't help but love him. Did a lot of great art, and he really will be missed.
I mean, it's been a crazy past couple of days, right? Because I thought recently there was another artist
Wayne England.
That also passed
Wayne
away.
England passed a few days ago, and probably Cryptic Command. I think he did the Command Cycle. He did
it's
a lot
one of my
of
favorite
art.
Cards.
Yeah. And it's with, you know, they come in threes, right? So does that mean yes. we've got another?
No. Let's not, you know, have something like that happen. But yes, very, very sad news. Chris Rush drew a lot of very, very iconic
cards. We got our top eight Christopher Rush cards at the end of the show. Check that out. But as I said before, you know, thoughts and prayers to Chris on his journey, and thoughts and prayers to Chris's family as they cope with his loss. All right. Well, you guys just got back from a Pro Tour, and what a Pro Tour it was. I mean, just crazy, crazy, crazy Pro Tour. Obviously, with the bannings in Modern, all eyes, I think, were on this Pro Tour. So taking a step back, before we dive into what Modern is, before we dive into Eldrazi and all that, just how was the Pro Tour, Paul?
It was a lot of fun. It turns out you have a lot more fun when you win matches. You know, that's not something that I'm used to at the Pro Tour.
Yeah.
But not only that, just as a collective, I think this is the best that our team's done at any Pro Tour. Mm-hmm. At least, you know, I've played in, you know, six Pro Tours. I don't even think it's close. And we were actually talking about, just in terms of overall success as a team, this might be one of the most, you know, the highest win percentage as a collective team mm-hmm. that any team's had in a really, really long time.
It was pretty insane.
Yeah.
Sam, how was your Pro Tour experience?
It was a lot of fun. So I was like 22nd, and I was the ninth best finish on the team.
Yeah. 22nd.
No, just as a sign of how great we did.
It was dominant. It was a great performance by you guys. You know, and when you start thinking that, you know, you got to carry dead weight on the team, it's pretty unbelievable. It's pretty unbelievable that you can do that.
Yeah.
So let's start by talking about what effect the bannings had on it's kind of a jumble, but what effect did the bannings have on your preparation for the Pro Tour?
Well, you know, we had, you know, this nice form because, you know, there were a bunch of us that worked kind of abroad, but we all kind of came to like a similar conclusion. Basically, you don't really want to be playing some kind of a reactive deck. I think everybody's just going to try to be as fast as possible because, you know, with the banning of Splinter Twin, you know, Splinter Twin was the deck that held all these unfair decks in check, mm-hmm. right? Because you can use your removal spells for various, you know, combo creature-based strategies like Infect. At the same time, you have cards like Remand, and even like cards like Pestermind Deceiver Exarch that bought you an extra turn to be able to, you know, be a little bit faster than those combo decks. And with that deck being gone, you know, Twin was kind of like the ultimate equalizer. I think just the format got a lot faster.
Sam, what was your initial thought process when you saw these bans hit?
Yeah, that was, I mean, it was like the floodgates are open now. You can play whatever, like, Storm, Infect, whatever turn 3 combo deck you want to try out is probably going to be good now. And also, for me personally, it meant I didn't have a fallback deck, because for the past couple of Pro Tours, it was like, well, whatever, I'll just play Birthing Pod if, you know, if I don't find something good, and that's fine.
Sam always plays the best decks.
Right, right.
And then it was the same for Twin, and that just wasn't available anymore.
Yeah. Wizards of the Coast, I hope you learned your lesson. You went after Sam Pardee. You took away his Birthing Pod. You took away his Splinter Twin, and he and Jacob drew a line in the sand. And that
They're
was
like,
it.
You know what? Screw you guys. We're going to break the format.
Yeah, yeah. You kicked the hornet's nest. It's time for Eldrazi.
Yeah.
So there was an article on the mothership on Wizards.com talking about it, and their prediction, oddly enough, was the rise of Tron. Like, these bannings were going to affect how, you know, the strength of Tron and kind of bring back Tron.
Tron was not a good choice.
Yeah, I mean, it is. It's odd because it seems like if you followed that script and bought into that storyline, you had a bad Pro Tour.
Yeah, yeah. I actually was winning a bunch of matches, but what got me ultimately off of it was, as I mentioned, the turn 3 decks. Yeah. I just could not beat Infect to save my life, mm-hmm. and I knew that Infect was going to be like, you know, comprise a large percentage of the metagame. A lot of members of Team Pantheon chose to play it. I think it was close to 10% of, you know, the Modern decks. So it would have been an awful choice. And I think a lot of people also came to a similar conclusion because it was not a heavily played deck at right. the Pro Tour.
Well, there is, I'm told by Andy that Luis's tournament report, his top 8 tournament report for the Pro Tour, is going to go up tonight. So if you want more insight on into some of the topics we're going to explore, like the Eldrazi and the testing and actual play at the tournament, check that out. Luis, I can say this, I think he's recording Limited Resources right now. Luis is still one of, if not my favorite writer. If you haven't read an LSV tournament report, do yourself a favor. Check out that tournament report tonight. I mean, come on, we're all reading Luis's articles. They're very entertaining, but he has a certain knack for it. And it despite all that, it will give you, I'm sure, a great insight into how to play the
although
deck.
Although he might be pretty rusty. It's been a while since he's had to write a tournament report.
There's been need to, right? His tournament report is actually more than a paragraph long this time.
Yeah, so. I mean, you look at this top eight, right? You have Luis, of course. He said he hasn't top eight since 2011.
Yeah.
Shuhei Nakamura, also top eight. And I'm like, hey, Shuhei. You know, he's a Hall of Famer. He's, you know, been on the train forever. I was like, when's the last time you top eight at a Pro Tour? Pro Tour Hollywood, 2008.
Hammer Time. PT Hammer Time.
He did not play Hammer Time because he's very smart.
That's why he top eighted. But it's hilarious. You say Pro Tour Hollywood, like Hammer Time.
Yeah, I know. 6 years. It's been 6 years since Shuhei Nakamura top eighted a Pro Tour.
So, you know, this was an amazing Pro Tour. We've already talked about the finishing. We're talking about all the great people in the top eight. A lot of that, Sam, rests with you and Jacob. Of course, I don't know if you guys out there realize this, Sam Pardee, Jacob Wilson, really the two brainchilds behind the Eldrazi deck that Team Channel Fireball and FTF played at the Pro Tour. So Sam, talk a bit about the development of that Eldrazi deck.
Yeah, so it started with the like generic black-white Eldrazi deck that sort of existed in the format before, and that deck was not very good. It had a bunch of like Relic of Progenitus and cards that we didn't really want to play because they cost mana and don't do anything. Mm-hmm. So then eventually we got around to, oh, well, we don't really like these processors. What if we just build a more aggressive version, which Jacob did with the mono colorless version. And he had Simeon Spirit Guide in there just to speed it up a little bit. That was sort of the first big breakthrough. And then once you get to be all colorless, I said, well, let's just do a gather search of colorless cards. And that was where we came up with Chalice of the Void and sort of realized, oh, hey, it's pretty easy to play a turn one Chalice for one in this format. And there's a lot of decks that play like 12 to 16 one drops that, you know, they might just lose if you do that. And that was sort of step two. And then we tried a few other colors. Like we tried, let's see if we add red for Eldrazi Obligator. We never tried the blue red thing that the Team East West Bowl got to. But we tried like, you know, just with red and just with blue, and none of those really seemed as powerful as getting to play. One of the big strengths of the colorless deck is you get to play as many lands with great abilities as you want. Basically, like we had Mutavault, Blinkmoth Nexus, Ghost Quarter, just so many lands that add value. So all of your mana sources do something. Either they tap for two mana or, you know, are creatures or whatever.
So where along in the process, because I know the process can be delicate, especially if you have a newer deck, did you and Jacob kind of figure out, okay, we've really got something here. We've got to focus on this deck. This deck is really, really something.
Probably around Friday, we were about to start GP Vancouver, so we were kind of taking a break from Constructed. But Jacob was like, yeah, I'm going to play this deck for sure. Other people on the team maybe hadn't played with it as much yet, and so they weren't quite as, you know, as ready. And so they, we had decided on Friday, and over the course of the Grand Prix weekend, just thinking about it, I was getting excited to play it because it just seemed like it was something so different and probably broken. Mm-hmm. There's always that, like, creeping fear that, oh, maybe we're wrong and maybe we're just going to fail spectacularly, but as it turns out, we didn't, and it worked out great.
So let's talk about this, Paul, because obviously you knew about this deck and you went with a different colorless strategy. You went with robots in playing Affinity.
Yeah.
How did you make that decision?
Well, as many of you already know, I am expecting a child very soon. So for this Pro Tour, I told the team, I'm like, look, I can't, you know, dedicate a week prior to the Pro Tour to test with you guys because, you know, Lisa could give birth at any moment. So I wanted to spend as much time as possible at home, you know, helping out with Kyle and just being there for her.
You got your phone on right now? What if something happens right? Andy,
phone,
do you have
my
your phone
is on?
Okay.
My phone is on. So
you better have that on silent.
Oh, wow. Unreal. You just tried to get me, I get you back. Anyways, so you know, I did a ton of testing. I did a lot of, you know, just testing generic like stockless on Modern through streaming, and then I you know, just played a lot, even, you know, when I wasn't streaming. And the deck that impressed me the most out of all the stack decks was the Affinity deck. It was just, I was just regularly going 4-1 or 5-0 in every single league I played in. Whereas the other decks, you know, it was clear that it had a lot of weaknesses. With Affinity, it's like, you know, I was impressed to just, you know, obviously it just crushes a lot of decks game one, but even after sideboard, you need to have incredibly hateful cards to actually be able to beat this deck, and sometimes it can even fight through those hateful cards.
Right.
And I was really, really impressed with how powerful the deck was. You get to play, like a game kind of like the Eldrazi deck. You get to play with cards that feel like maybe they shouldn't be a card you should be allowed to play modern, like Mox Opal. Mm-hmm. You know, Mox Opal is just a completely busted card, and any hand that you have Mox Opal and get to play your spells, you feel like you're playing a different format. And that's why I chose to play the deck. The reason why I chose not to play the Eldrazi deck was because I didn't test with it online at all. Mm-hmm. I showed up on Thursday, the day before the Pro Tour. 17 of the 20 people were locked into playing the deck, and I was like, well,
for those of you who don't follow our discussion about testing for the Pro Tour and being part of the Pro Tour testing, 17 out of 20 of the team playing the deck is overwhelming. Like, it's so rare that high a majority actually signs on for a deck.
Especially considering that it's modern, where there's a bunch of different viable decks. Mm-hmm. And even amongst our team, we have all great players, but, you know, everybody has a certain style of deck that they like to play.
Sure.
But 17 people locked into this deck, a ton of people were locked in. I was like, you know, there really must be something to this deck. I haven't played a single game with it, though, and I'm pretty comfortable with Affinity. Mm-hmm. And, you know, to be honest, you know, I talked to other people, and nobody really faulted me for choosing to play Affinity.
Sure.
They were just like, yeah, Affinity is a great deck too. I'm not going to fault you if you want. You know, if I was going to play Tron, I'm sure a bunch of people would be like, look, Paul, don't do it.
Oh, yeah. I would have had a problem with that.
Yeah.
Well, let me ask you this then, Paul. If you go back and do it again, would you audible having shown up, or do you think sticking to Affinity would still... I mean, you had a great Pro Tour.
Right.
You know, you had a great Pro Tour.
Yeah, I think I would have played the Eldrazi deck. You know, after looking at how people... you know, the amount of success people had with the deck, and just looking at what the deck's trying to do, it's really not that hard of a deck to pick up and play.
Mm-hmm.
As long as you just kind of know what your opponent's playing and know what to chalice for, that's the hardest part. And I think mulliganing is the hardest part. And if I just goldfished with the deck a bunch, figured that part out, I think I would have done pretty well. But at the same time, I, you know, don't feel bad for playing Affinity, because I think Affinity...
How do you feel bad? What did you finish?
Well, not even just my finish, just in terms of like what decks were out there, and just how Affinity fared, right?
Yeah.
You had it still put two copies into the top eight.
Yeah, no, it was
so clearly
it was
that was the other deck to play for this tournament. Mm-hmm. So I don't feel bad. If I played something like some terrible deck like Burn or something,
Hammer
time. I don't know who would consider playing that deck on our team. But if you played that, yeah, that would have been
who
a bad
played
choice.
Burn?
Raptor.
He had the best win percentage out of all of us.
Oh yeah, Raptor went 5-4.
5-2.
Oh yeah, yeah. So he went 5-2, lost to two teammates, and then got a concession in the last round.
Oh my
so
gosh.
Technically, he did have the best win percentage,
because
we don't generally count matchups against teammates.
That makes sense.
Because like I went 1-1 against teammates, so I went 6-2, I guess, overall.
So Sam, you alluded to it, the blue-red East-West Bowl Eldrazi deck. Having considered it and kind of being like the resident Eldrazi expert, but I don't know if you and Jacob had a chance to talk about it. Going back, thinking about the brewing, thinking about the process, do you guys think you missed something, or do you still like the colorless version better?
It's hard to say. I think if we knew that other teams were going to show up with the blue-red deck, we might have needed to do so. But from what I hear from them, our deck might have been better against the field. They said they were a little more scared of their infect matchup, and they had a few more scary matchups than we did. So... it's kind of a trade-off. They certainly were better in the mirror, and because so many of us showed up with the colorless one, they got to beat us a lot, because we were doing quite well. Like I lost to the eventual winner JC in the in round 14 or something, pretty late in the tournament, and then he beat all three of us in the top eight. All three.
Yeah, I think he was like 6-0 against.
He just mowed down
the colorless Eldrazi deck. He played Shuhei in the top eight,
Luis
in the top four, and Yvonne Flock in the finals.
So
unreal.
I mean, you know, it's so funny.
Can you imagine, like you know, we talk about to have success at the Pro Tour, you know, combination of skill and luck, whatever, right?
Yeah.
Imagine just playing in the top eight of the Pro Tour and just playing three favorable matchups, just all the exact same deck in a row.
Well,
that's unreal.
It's so funny. We were talking about this. Here's a little inside baseball for everyone. We were debating what top eight to do this week, and the one we didn't end up doing was top eight dominant Pro Tour decks. And maybe we'll come back to that at a different Magic TV because it was a good list. But one
you
of
need
the,
to do that show with like John. So like you
there's
guys,
a lot
you
of old there's a lot of old school
decks.
Ones. Yeah. But one of the ones we talked about was I know it was Invasion Block constructed, but it was where Team Alphabet Unlimited put four of the same deck in the top eight. Right. It was red green. And similar to this scenario, Zvi Maushewitz won that Pro Tour playing a deck he called The Solution because it was good against rest of the field, but it destroyed red-green.
Right.
And he knew about the red-green deck. ABU shows up, puts four in the top eight with Zvi, who then just mows him down.
Right.
Similar, exact same scenario, yeah.
And so, if you want to talk about dominant decks, I mean, two different teams came up with an Eldrazi deck and put five copies. I mean, there were six Eldrazi decks in the top eight.
Yeah.
So if you want to talk about a single deck and its impact in a format at a Pro Tour, mm-hmm. this has got to be up there.
Well, I think it's more like, you know, a single strategy.
Right.
You know, a single...
Thought Not Seers and Reality Smashers.
Eldrazi Temples and Eyes of Ugin.
Yeah, I mean, this deck, that's the thing. You get to, if, like I said, with Affinity, it almost feels like you're playing vintage mm-hmm. to a certain degree.
Oh, because everything's so quick and cheap, right?
Well, you get to play Eye of Ugin, which basically acts as like an Ancient Tomb, and Eldrazi Temple. You get to play a deck with basically eight Ancient Tombs in your deck.
Mm-hmm.
It's actually unreal. I saw a tweet, I believe it might have been Tom Ross, but he was playing the modern Eldrazi deck versus like a vintage Dax deck or something, and they were going 50-50.
Jeez.
That is crazy.
It's crazy.
At one point, we were considering adding Trinisphere to our deck, so.
Wow.
We were basically a shops deck.
Lodestone Golem.
Oh, that was on the list. The
it's
last
not
four
an Eldrazi.
Cards we had to play were not good.
Yeah.
Was
yeah.
there? So let me ask you this, Sam. Were there points where you were like, this is too gimmicky. This deck is, we can't.
Oh, yeah. I mean, when everybody who first looked at the list was like, well, this doesn't look very good. You're like, Simeon Spirit guiding into a 5/5. What if they just kill it? That's just
seems
not, that's
terrible.
Just not the thing. Yeah, but you know, then we it actually felt very similar to two Pro Tours ago when we played the Blue Red Thopter deck,
mm-hmm.
where you look at the list and you're like, man, this deck looks really bad. And then you play 10 games or whatever, and you'd have lost seven of them to it. And then you know, then you do it again, and you're like, well, maybe they just got lucky. And you try again, and then you lose another seven. And then at some point, they're just not getting lucky. The deck's just really good.
Yeah, to be fair, it took a little more convincing for people to kind of, you know, adopt the blue-red deck as opposed to this one. I felt like a lot more people were like, yeah, this deck's great.
Yeah. This deck has more busted mana, which I think gets people on board faster.
Yeah. I mean, you know, it only takes a couple of games where you win on turn three just by playing, you know, 4/4s and 5/5s for you know, two mana. Where you're just like, this deck seems kind of dumb.
I'm like watching it. Yeah. It's so funny, and I know all of us on this side are in this category where we're watching this deck play out, and I know it's so different just talking to people and seeing the emails and, you know, talking to you, Paul, Raptor, Luis, that there's a lot of nervousness, particularly when you're going out on a limb with a new deck because it seems good. It's testing well. You think you got it right. When you're watching this deck on coverage, it's like, no brainer. This deck's insane. What are you guys even talking about? Like, I mean, how did R&D not know about this? Like, what's going on here? Like, of course you play this deck. Because when you watch this deck play out on coverage, you're like, what the heck is happening right now?
And not only that too, right? Because you're playing this brand new deck in modern. This is a format where people have played hundreds of thousands of hours, right? Trying to break the format, trying to play all these different strategies. You know, it's pretty defined, right? And it's years and years of people just fine-tuning their lists. Mm-hmm. And then you're just playing this brand new deck.
Mm-hmm.
You're just like, is this really going to be able to compete with all these like incredibly fine-tuned lists mm-hmm. that people have, you know, spent years mastering? And yeah, I mean, turns out when you get to play, like once again, Eldrazi Temple, Eye of Ugin, you get to do some pretty silly things. You get to play these gigantic creatures at, you know, like incredibly cheap rate. It's just, it's crazy.
I don't want to dive too into this topic right this instant.
Right.
We'll circle back to it later on this Magic TV. But, Sam, do you and Jacob put this Eldrazi deck together without the bannings?
We probably would have tried it. I don't think we would have played it.
Interesting. So, okay. I mean, let's say Bloom is banned, but Twin's still in.
the deck looks significantly different, I think. Like, you have Cavern of Souls. Mm-hmm. You probably need way more. You probably can't be colorless because you need, you know, you'd be worried that just four Dismember is not enough removal, not enough ways to interact with the Splinter Twin plan.
Would you still be playing this deck, or would you be more like, actually, I'll play Splinter Twin?
I think I probably would have played Twin, but it's hard to say for sure.
It's interesting. There is a great video series, which Sam is in, on the website right now. Playing in Chion, your matchup was what? The Splinter Twin matchup?
Yep.
So he plays against Paul Eldrazi versus Splinter Twin. Great videos. Watch it. And then
actually had some good matches, though.
Yeah.
It was better than the blue ones.
Yeah. There's also, we put together with Tom Martell, a Pardee versus Martell, Eldrazi versus Summer Bloom matchup. That one didn't go quite as well. But in all fairness, I don't think, for all the brouhaha with the bannings, I don't think really much of it was centered around Summer Bloom. It was really all about Splinter Twin.
Yeah. Everybody knew that the Bloom ban was coming, was kind of expecting it, and thought, you know, everybody was okay with that. Like, that needed to happen. The Splinter Twin one, not as much.
Yeah. But. So let's dive more into the testing, the actual testing for the Pro Tour. What are the other decks? Like, I mean, we all know Eldrazi. Like you said, 17 out of 20 of you went with Eldrazi. Chion, of course, on the Affinity plan. But what are the other decks that you were considering, Sam?
Affinity was my number two. We played a ton of matches with it, just against all the other decks in the format, and that deck is really unfair. like Chion was saying, you know, you'd play against somebody. We'd play post-board games. I'd have four Stony Silences. And I was playing against John Stern. I drew him in 9 out of 10 of the games, and I still lost 5.
Jeez.
So it's just, that deck is just unbelievable. Ad Nauseam was another deck early in the testing that we felt could have benefited from the bannings. It was a deck that I always thought was a little underplayed based on how good I thought it was, but we had some trouble with Infect with that deck, and also the Affinity matchup was not great. So those were sort of the decks that we were considering. And then, you know, I of course, tried a bunch of Voice of Resurgence decks because can't keep a good man down. Yeah. But that card is not very good.
It doesn't seem like that the metagame's currently in a good spot for that. Blue decks aren't really where you want to be. Voice of Resurgence is good against Snapcaster decks, but there's not a whole lot of Snapcaster decks.
Not a lot going on. Yeah. Paul, what about you? You weren't there live testing, but I know on the stream you were playing a lot of Modern.
Right.
What else were you considering besides Affinity?
So I had it narrowed down to about, I guess, 3 to 4 decks. Affinity was definitely my top choice, which is kind of funny because I actually didn't own all the Affinity cards prior to testing for this Pro Tour because, you know, I prefer kind of, you know, maybe control strategies and mid-range strategies. So Affinity was never something that was on my radar. And I was just like, well, you know, for this Pro Tour, I'm just going to try out everything. Uh-huh. And I tried out a lot of bad decks, too. But I also was, you know, able to be pleasantly surprised, like Affinity. I tried Living End, and I thought the Living End deck was actually not bad. And I was winning some matches with Burn. I thought Burn was okay. I was actually winning games with Tron. But towards the end, I started losing to a bunch of Infect decks, which kind of put me off of it. So at the end, I was basically between Affinity, Living End, and basically the team deck. And those are my choices. Towards the end of testing, a lot of people weren't having as much success playing the Living End deck. So I was then kind of basically just choosing between Affinity and the team deck. And I just went with Affinity because I played so many matches leading up to the Pro Tour with that deck. I felt very comfortable playing that deck.
So is the rule, like, assuming an anonymous account, is the rule you cannot play the team deck on Magic Online?
I don't know if that was a rule, but I chose not to play the team deck online.
Sam, is there a rule about this?
I would say if the team deck had been stock Affinity, no one would care if you played that online, probably on an anonymous account. But with this Eldrazi deck, we wouldn't have wanted people to play that online.
Didn't want that to go
That's
anywhere.
One of the main reasons, because I'm just like, I'm not going to play this deck just because it seems like a deck that not a lot of people would necessarily come up with. Like, this, you know, like, what if I'm just like playing a league match and I just go turn one Chalice for one? And somebody testing for a Pro Tour is like, wow, that's really sweet tech. I'm going to play Chalice in my deck. That would be really bad.
Right.
So I was just like, I'm going to jam some games with Affinity and just, you know, get a feel if everybody's on board with the deck. And everybody was on board with the deck, but I still went with Affinity.
Sam, what metagame were you preparing for with the Eldrazi deck?
We expected the top. We sort of had a top 5. We had Affinity, Infect, Burn, some sort of green-black deck. We thought Junk was more likely, but, you know, you never know about that. And Tron as sort of the five most popular decks. And then we, you know, the rest sort of just other, like, 5% of the field sort of for the rest of the other decks in Modern.
And Paul, you were clued into that, so that was what you were prepared for as well.
Yeah. So, same thing. I mean, then if you look at the top five decks, that's why they chose to play Chalice of the Void, because, you know, that does shore up a lot of
real low curve. Yeah,
right. It really shores up a lot of kind of the deck's weaknesses. You know, against these like, really low curve decks like Burn, you know, they have a ton of one drops, and even Infect. You know, you basically, you know, I've tried Infect and I've been Chalice for one before. Mm-hmm. Not even playing against a team deck, and you just can't do anything. It's really, really hard to be able to, you know, finish them off. And, I mean, I think that Chalice innovation to go with the Simian Spirit Guides is really what kind of put the deck over the top for those guys.
So can I say, I heard this story from Channel Fireball Director of Sales and Marketing, Tommy Adams. No idea if it's true. And I was like, this sounds a little bit weird, but it involves you, Paul, at the Pro Tour, supposedly sitting down in between at the same table as two of your teammates and having them start playing Eldrazi. And you hadn't started playing yet?
Oh, yeah. This was pretty insane. So this is the first round of Modern.
Okay.
This is round four, and I'm playing against somebody that I know is playing Affinity because he watches my stream, and he just yelled, "I am playing Affinity, guys," because nobody knows who he actually is in person.
Right.
But I knew who he was. I'm just like, yeah, you're playing Affinity. And I'm playing him. It's turn one. I've mulliganed. I have a pretty bad hand. He goes turn one, creature, steel, overseer on turn one. And I draw for my turn. And I just know that I can't beat this hand. Like, I don't have a Galvanic Blast. All I'm going to do is play a turn one Signal Pest. I'm going to lose this game. To my left, Matt Ness. To my right, Nathan Holliday.
Yeah.
They're both on
going
the Eldrazi.
Eldrazi.
So I'm just like, well, you know, the sideboard cards are so impactful in the Affinity Mirror that I don't want him to bring in sideboard cards against me. And I'm like, 5% to win this game, if you know, just because I cannot beat what he has. So just like, you know what, I'm just going to concede. So I concede before playing a single card. In sideboarding, he's looking to my left, looking to my right, trying to figure out what to sideboard, because he's just like, well, I'm assuming you're playing the team deck here.
Did he actually say that to you?
Yes.
Oh, my God.
Because he's like, I think you're on their team.
Oh, my God. You guys are all wearing the same shirt.
So then he sideboards in a bunch of Thought Seizes.
Nice.
To try to get, you know, the Thought Knots here in Reality Smashers.
It's amazing in the Affinity Mirror.
And then so game two, I smash him. You know, I draw my Ancient Grudges. I get to play it. In his hand, he's holding a useless Thought Seize that didn't do anything. And so I managed to get him game two. Unfortunately, you know, the jig was up for game three. He was on the play, and he managed to give me the third game. But it was still kind of a sweet moment. That was probably one of the sweeter moments for me at the tournament. I had thought about it for a while. I'm like, okay, what are my chances of winning this game? Cyborg cards are super important. I think it actually is the correct play here to concede.
Yeah.
I'm still not sure if it was correct or not.
Okay.
But I just knew, based on the complexion of my hand, I've played this matchup before, I was just such a huge dog to win this game.
Well, there were some great moments, particularly with the Eldrazi deck. And it did seem like whoever got off to the hot start was going to win the matchup.
Yeah.
And I think most of us saw, if you watch any coverage, you watched the Luis and Frank Lepore match.
Oh, yeah.
And that was kind of the gut shot heard around the world, right? Like, I was seeing tweets about it. I didn't watch it live. Seeing tweets and Facebook posts about this gut shot, so I ended up watching it. And, of course, he had an insane Oblivion Sower play, which was kind of backbreaking. So the gut shot was almost kind of icing on the cake, because Luis, with that Oblivion Sower, was about to take control of the game.
Yeah.
But I hear there's an even better Oblivion Sower story from the Pro Tour.
I think I might have a better gut shot story even, too.
All right, wait. Double up, Sam.
I'm playing against Shuhei at, 10-2 or something. I have him at 1. I attack him with a Blink Moth Nexus and Ghost Quarter both of his Blink Moth Nexuses. So I'm thinking, I got this. He's going to die. He has two cards left in his hand. Exile Simian Spirit Guide. Gutshot your Blink Moth Nexus.
Oh, just hard cast?
Just hard cast.
Oh, my.
Red mana.
It is red mana.
Oh, my God.
Because he's at 1. He can't cast.
He can't. No Phyrexian mana.
Yeah.
That's awesome. He just cast the gunshot.
Wow. Did not see that coming.
Little known fact.
Hoisted on your own petard. He got you with your own deck, Sam.
Oh, that's awesome.
All right, what about Jacob and his Sower?
So Jacob's Oblivion Sower one. He's playing against a Bant, Geist of St. Traft, Voice of Resurgence sort of deck. and he's dead on board, cannot possibly win. His opponent has like a million creatures. Jacob has like a 5/5 or whatever in play, draws and plays an Oblivion Star. He has one mana left over and has an Urborg in play. The four cards he hits are Misty Rainforest, Misty Rainforest, Misty Rainforest, and Rogue's Passage, which was a card we had joked about putting in our deck, but didn't even consider, really, and didn't think anyone else was going to be playing, certainly.
What does Rogue's Passage do?
Target creature becomes unblockable until end of turn.
You just tap it?
Right. So apparently Jacob was in this board
four
stall.
Four tap, so he needed all of the lands that he hit also.
Yeah, yeah. So Jacob was in a situation where it's like this huge board stall, and there's like his opponent has multiple Voice of Resurgences in play. So Jacob can't really attack because that Voice of Resurgence is just going to become some gigantic creature.
Right.
So he's just like, well, I need something to get out of this. Oblivion Sower, hit Rogue Passage, which is a card nobody plays in Modern, to give his creatures.
I don't think I've ever seen one in play in Modern.
Yeah, to give his creatures unblockable and attack for
a
few turns.
Oh my god. Wow, blowout. That is way better than Luis's Oblivion Sower. Way better. Sorry, Luis. I was championing you on two plays and party.
Man, I
just
wish
blew
I had these
out.
Sweet plays, but I was just playing Boring Affinity.
Oh, boo hoo.
Yeah.
Boo hoo. We'll